Do you know what worship is? Worship is simply a response to what Scripture tells us. Scriptures like the one in Psalm 100, 1 to 5, which says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before Him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Imagine God, the creator of the whole universe and everything in it, chose to breathe us into life. And He's saying to us that we are His and He is ours, and that He wants to take care of us and love us for all eternity. Imagine si God sinasabi sa'yo, akin ka, at aalagaan kita, at mamahalin kita, magpakailanman. Amazing. Doesn't that just blow your mind? And guess what? You don't have to imagine it because it's real. So, let's worship.
Hallelujah. Run for makes clear the way. Yes, I must race, for every step means one less chance remains. Through every open door I shout, my God Almighty reigns.
For as long as there are souls in need, then I will lead the charge. And as long as there are giants to be slain, and as long as there are battles for the kingdom to be won, I will swing the sword that signifies God's reign.
Our God, God Almighty, our God Almighty,
God Almighty,
God Almighty,
God Almighty,
our God Almighty,
God Almighty,
our God Almighty,
God Almighty,
God Almighty.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Ako nga po pala si Marvin Adel ng ICOC Batangas. Alam niyo po, we all have choices in life every single day. Pagmulat pa lang po ng ating mga mata sa umaga, sa ayon sa gusto, pipili at pipili ka. Pwede mong piliin na magstay ka sa kama o pwede mong piliin na bumangon ka at simulan mo yung buhay. The choices we make have a major impact sa ating buhay. Kaya naman napaka-importante na bawat pagpili natin, sisiguraduhin natin na maganda at magiging impact nito sa ating pamumuhay at syempre sa pamumuhay ng mga mahal natin. Sabi nga po ng isang quote, "You are free to make whatever choice you want, but you are not free from the consequences of the choice." Kaya po napaka-importante ng pagpili. And today, sa communion, alalahanin muli natin ang isang tao na mas piniling mahirapan, piniling mamatay sa cross kaysa ang magbuhay hari kasama ang Ama sa langit. Sino po siya? Marang iba, siyempre, kundi si Jesus Christ. Alam niyo po ba na sa pamamagitan ng kanyang pagpili, may dalawang importanteng regalo na tinanggap ang bawat sa atin? Una, ang pagpapatawad. Pangalawa, ang pagkakaroon ng magandang kinabukasan. Basahin po natin sa Luke chapter 23, in verses 33 to 34 and verses 39 to 43. Sabi po dito, pagdating nila sa lugar na tinatawag na bungo, ipinako nila sa cross si Jesus at ang dalawang kriminal. Ang isa ay sa kanan ni Jesus at ang isa ay sa kaliwa. Sinabi ni Jesus, "Ama, patawarin mo sila dahil hindi nila nalalaman ang kanilang ginagawa." Nagpalabunutan ang mga sundalo para paghati-hatian ang mga damit ni Jesus. Ininsulto rin si Jesus ng isa sa mga kriminal sa tabi niya. "Hindi ba ikaw ang Kristo? Ilikas mo ang sarili mo pati na kami." Pero sinaway siya ng isa sa mga kriminal na nakapako. "Hindi ka ba natatakot sa Diyos? Ikaw man ay pinaparusahan din ng kamatayan. Dapat lang naparusahan tayo ng kamatayan dahil sa mga ginawa nating kasalanan. Pero ang taong ito'y walang ginawang masama." Pagkatapos ay sinabi niya, "Jesus, alalahanin niyo ako kapag naghari na kayo." Sumagot si Jesus, "Sasabihin ko sa iyo ang totoo. Ngayon din ay makakasama kita sa paraiso." Alam niyo sa passage na binasa natin, mapapansin natin na yung dalawang kriminal. At mapapansin natin itong dalawang kriminal na ito na meron silang common sa isa't isa. Ano po yun? Una is, syempre, pareho silang kriminal. Pangalawa, pareho silang nakapako sa cross. Pangatlo, sila po ay may hatol ng kamatayan dahil sa mga ginawa nila. At pang-apat, both of them ay kilala nila si Jesus Christ. Marami silang common sa buhay, pero nung ma-meet nila si Jesus Christ, magkaiba ang choices na ginawa nila. Yung unrepentant criminal, ininsulto at hinamak si Jesus. Tinuya at nagpakita ng walang respeto. Pero itong repentant criminal, mas pinili ang aminin ang mga kasalanan, i-humble ang sarili, at humingi ng pagpapatawad kay Jesus Christ. Katulad po ng dalawang kriminal na katabi ni Jesus, lahat tayo ay nagkakasala at patuloy nagkakasala. Ang karapat dapat po sa atin ay kamatayan at kaparusahan. But through Jesus Christ, He offered us forgiveness and a great future. Pero isang bagay na gusto makita ni Jesus sa atin, ang piliin nating mag-respond tulad ng pag-respond ng repentant criminal. We need to admit na nagkasala tayo at ihambong natin ang ating mga sarili. Humingi po tayo ng pagpapatawad kay God at tanggapin ang pangako ni Jesus na magkakaroon ng magandang kinabukasan. As we take the bread and drink the wine, let us happily accept our gifts, the gift of forgiveness and a great future. Manalangin po tayo mga kapatid. Heavenly Father, maraming salamat Panginoon sa pagkakataon na kami po ay muling aalalahanin namin ang ginawa ni Jesus sa cross. Salamat po sa pagpili niya. Dahil sa kanyang pagpili, kami po ay nagkaroon ng magandang regalo. Ito po ay pagpapatawad buhat sa iyo at pagkakaroon ng magandang kinabukasan kasama ka. God, hindi po namin deserve ang lahat ng ito, Panginoon. Hindi po kami karapat-dapat natanggapin ang pagmamahal mo. Hindi po kami karapat-dapat na pag-alayan ng buhay ni Jesus. Pero dahil sa pagpili ni Jesus, Panginoon, nagkaroon kami ng pagkakataon. Nawa tanggapin mo, Panginoon, ang gagawin din namin, Panginoon, na pag-take ng bread at ng wine. Ito po yung isang simbolo na kung saan tinatanggap namin ang pagmamahal mo, ang pangako mo at pagpapatawad mo. Maraming salamat po sa pangalan po ni Jesus. Amen.
Dako tayo sa isang importanteng bahagi pa ng ating serbisyo, yung pagbibigay. Alam niyo po ba that 15% of what Jesus says in the Bible talks about treasured possession or money. Mas madalas niya pa po itong pinag-usapan kesa sa heaven or hell. So ako naniniwala that there's a fundamental connection on how we think about between our spiritual life and how we handle our possession or money. Buksan po natin ang Biblia natin sa Matthew chapter 6 verse 19 to 21. Matthew chapter 6 verse 19 to 21. Sabi dito ni Jesus, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moths and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasure in heaven where moths and vermin do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Jesus doesn't just tell us where not to put our treasure. He also gives the best investment advice you'll ever hear. Sabi niya, store up for yourselves treasure in heaven, in verse 20. Pero I thought Jesus is against storing up treasures. Hindi pala, no? He even command us. Jesus, he has a treasure mentality. He wants us to store up treasure. He's just telling us to stop storing them in a wrong place and start storing them in a right place. Hindi ba parang mali yung mag-store in our own interest? Wouldn't it be selfish? Hindi naman po, no? God expects and commands us to act and out of enlightened self-interest. He wants us to live into His glory. Pero ang glory na binibigay natin kay God is always to our good. Yun yung kagandahan doon. No? Sabi nga ni John Piper, God is more glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. No? Yung selfishness is when we pursue gain in the expense of others. When you store up treasures for yourselves in heaven, it doesn't reduce yung treasure that are available to others. In fact, no, it is by serving God and helping others, giving to others, that we store up heavenly treasure. Everyone gain, no one loses, no. Yung present joy natin, manggaling din yung anticipation sa future joy na pinramis ni Jesus that those who sacrifice on earth would receive 100 times as much in heaven. Sabi niya sa Matthew 19:29. That is about 10,000%. Very impressive return, no? Pero of course, Jesus Himself is our ultimate treasure, mga kapatid. So sa ating pagbibigay, remember that we are doing the best investment. We are storing a lasting treasure. No, napaka-importante po nito kay Jesus. Kaya po sa ngayong umaga sa ating pagbibigay ay isipin natin na ito po'y gagawin natin dahil din kay Jesus. Sabay-sabay po tayong manalangin sa ating pagbibigay. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that we have this opportunity to give to our brothers and sisters. May you continue to be with our church. Yung makukolek po, bigyan mo po ng wisdom, understanding, deeper discernment upang ma-meet at matulungan namin yung mas nangangailangan mga kapatiran din namin. Father, salamat po for this opportunity. We love you, we praise you, God. In Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
mapasa amin ang kaharian mo, sundin ang loob mo.
Good morning, everyone. It's such an honor to be speaking to you all today. My name is Dan Liu. My wife, Alexa, and I, I serve as elder, and of course, herself as elder's wife in Hong Kong. But right now, we are temporarily in the United States. So even though I'm not Filipino, I want to wish all of you mabuhay if you are here this morning in one of the churches in the Philippines. As mentioned, I'm actually here now in the United States, and because of the COVID-19 pandemic, we have been visiting family now since the middle of December of 2021. So by the time this sermon is aired, however, Lord willing, we should be back in Hong Kong and in mandatory quarantine, and we will be restarting our lives there where our two sons, our daughter-in-law, and our one-year-old grandson now live. So we'll be back together with them, Lord willing, by the middle of May. So today, this invitation to preach is really a privilege. And I want to begin by saying thank you very much to Dr. Roland. Truly, I really respect and appreciate his teaching and his scholarship so much. You know, a few years ago, he came to Hong Kong and did a series on the book of Deuteronomy for our part of the church there. He did some classes and he did a Sunday service for us. And I really admire the way that he has a great love for the Bible. He presents it very simply and very clearly, though, so that it's accessible to all of us. Thank you, Roland, for your example. And again, I'm very honored to speak to you all here in the Philippines. In my mind and heart, the Philippine churches are examples of faith in God and a great love for God. And I do hope that today, together as we explore the scriptures, the Holy Spirit will guide us and help us so much. It's also meaningful for me right now at this time to preach to you, because right now, if my father were still alive, he would be celebrating his 100th birthday on May 23rd. 2022, which would be just a day after today, this service. Just last month here in America, we were able to organize an in-person time of remembrance, a memorial time for my father. And he passed away early in 2021 during the pandemic. So we have not been able as a family to gather until just this past month. So Lord willing, this time when I return back to Hong Kong, I will be bringing my father and my mother's cremated ashes with me, because eventually I know my father's, one of his last desires was for his ashes to go back to his hometown village in China. And that's my goal, to take them there. So this opportunity, this Sunday, this time is actually very significant for me. Having said all this, let's now turn to the scriptures. Today, I'm following just a traditional schedule, and we have two passages, one in John chapter 14 and the other in Acts chapter 16. And again, may God speak to us through these passages. If you need a title for today, let's call it The Holy Spirit at Work. And today I'm going to be reading from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. So let's look at our first passage here. Let's look and read John 14, verses 23 to 29. I'm going to pick up the conversation that Jesus was having with his disciples. It says here in verse 23, Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. And the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. You know, during this discussion or conversation that Jesus was having with his disciples here in John 14, he was posed a question by Judas, not Iscariot, but Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world? It's interesting here that the disciple Judas wanted to know how exclusive the future knowledge of Jesus would be. But Jesus doesn't quite answer that question. Jesus keeps it more open. He notes that those who love him will keep his word. My mind, I don't know about you, but my mind goes to other people, such as in the book of Acts, like Cornelius, or like Lydia, the dealer in purple cloth. The key is those people who keep God's word. And it says here, Jesus says, that we will come. He says, meaning himself, meaning God, meaning the Holy Spirit, they will come and make their home with those people who keep God's word. So I find it very beautiful the way this divine humility works out here. We see that the Father sends the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name, but before the Holy Spirit comes, Jesus must leave so that the Spirit may be able to come. And then, as Jesus says here, the Spirit will remind you, or remind us, all that Jesus had said before. And I just love the way that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit are so intertwined together. It's a point that I've seen, and someone who was reading the scriptures with me, a sister that is very close to me in Hong Kong, also pointed out. And then as Jesus continues to talk, he predicts about how the Holy Spirit will come. He says that the Holy Spirit is the Advocate and will speak and teach us everything that Jesus had once taught. And talking about the Advocate, I know here, and I'm speaking before people who are much better teachers than myself, but we know that the Advocate is in Greek's parakletos, or parakletos, which means one called alongside to help. So the Holy Spirit is like a helper, meaning that, okay, we are at the mission, we are at God's work, and the helper is coming alongside with us. The Holy Spirit is like a comforter. And boy, don't we need comfort so much in our lives? Intercessor. When we have needs that need to be brought before God, the Holy Spirit acts as an intercessor. And as mentioned, an advocate. When I think of an advocate, I think of someone standing in a courtroom and I'm sitting there, perhaps being on trial. So who is the advocate arguing with? Well, he's arguing with the other lawyer or counselor, and also advocating before the judge, who of course is God. And then there's a lovely, just an image that I keep in mind when I think about the Holy Spirit. And, you know, there's this game called rugby where people run around and they seem like really violent people, but they're tackling people and everything like that. But there's a phrase in the game of rugby where a man's running and he tosses the ball next to the person running alongside him. And the running alongside him is his teammate. And he says, with you, the phrase is with you. And you know, I really believe that in that sense, the Holy Spirit is like that. When we are running down the field or trying to make a play or even trying to get somewhere, the phrase with you is there because the Holy Spirit is saying, I am with you. So these are powerful descriptions of the Holy Spirit. And it says here in verse 27 that the Holy Spirit also brings peace. Jesus wanted them to have peace. And even after he came back in his resurrected body, he wanted the people, he wanted his disciples to have peace. And he says, I do not give to you as the world gives. I do not speak to you as the world speaks. You know, I've reflected on this for a long time in my life. So often in my life, I have taken the word of man or of friends and even family as if it were always going to come through. The promise was always going to come through. But I know this, that with man, so often, including myself, I fail. But God's word always comes through. So Jesus wants us to be at peace. He wants us to have courage. And he is very humble. He says he is going to the Father who is greater than him. And then later on, because Jesus has gone, the Holy Spirit will come and lead us. I love it. And here in verse 29, we see even as in the whole book of John, an evangelistic edge to the message. It says here in verse 29 again, and now I've told you this because before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe. Jesus wants them to believe that it will happen exactly as he says it will, that the Holy Spirit truly is at work. So what is he predicting? What is he foretelling? Is he foretelling his crucifixion, his death and resurrection? And yes, be at peace, even at those times? Is he foreshadowing the time when he will ascend into heaven, when he goes to the Father? Or is he giving us a foretaste, a foreshadowing of what happens in the book of Acts, when the Holy Spirit comes down and when the people are inspired and then the door of salvation is opened to the Gentiles in Acts 10, when Peter calls all the Gentiles who obeyed to believe? These are the kind of things that this passage points to. And, you know, since we're already pointing that way, let's take a look at our second scripture for today, and that is in Acts chapter 16. And I'm going to read Acts 16 here. This is, again, something that I believe that we are blessed to be able to read together. In Acts 16, we're going to look at an example of the Holy Spirit at work. And we're going to pick up the reading here in verse 9 to verse 15. Acts 16, verse 9. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia pleading with him and saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in the city for some days. On the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate by the river, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had gathered there. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home. And she prevailed upon us. You know, this is a wonderful story, a wonderful just piece of cloth in the middle of the book of Acts, where suddenly Luke starts talking about we, but there's this vision that I think many of us heard before about the Macedonian man calling them to come over. And, you know, if you take a look at the map here, you'll see that Paul and his friends were traveling through Asia Minor, what is known as Turkey, and they were trying to preach in places like Asia or in Bithynia, but it seemed like the Spirit of God kept closing the door. And then they finally arrived in Troas, which is a city right on the coast. After the vision that Paul had seen, then, I love the way the scripture talks about it, they go straight to Macedonia. Immediately, they go right by Samothrace, and they go right through the city of Neapolis. They go right into Macedonia, into Europe, to the leading city, Philippi. Wow, isn't this very interesting? They seem to have heard the call, and they go straight. And then, it's interesting here, if you look at this piece of the scripture where it says, once they got to Philippi, It says, we remained in this city for some days. Now, you know, Philippi was the leading city of the area of Macedonia, and it was well known as a Roman colony, meaning that, wow, the Romans not only had control over so much in the Mediterranean, but this was actually really a colony. And if you think about it, yes, the people of the city truly obeyed Caesar. They truly followed Rome and everything that Rome stood for. And so imagine, Paul was there. They ran, they traveled through straight on to this leading city. And then what do? They pause. They remain there for some days. What do we do now? Perhaps it was a new setting. Perhaps it was maybe a setting that they weren't familiar with. Perhaps because it was a Roman colony, they were like, okay, now what? It's like the expression, hurry up, and wait. But then what happens? On the Sabbath, they go looking for a place of prayer. Now, I don't know. I've read some things. Is this place of prayer actually by the riverside? Well, it says so, but is it actually an indoor place or an outdoor place? I've always imagined it to be an outdoor place, but I've read somewhere where some people say, no, it's actually really like a synagogue. But anyway, this was a Roman city. Maybe there was no synagogue, so what do? They go to this place of prayer, and then Paul and his companions were persuaded by the hospitality of someone named Lydia. They were not so self-driven as to insist on going somewhere else. They didn't stick to their own plan. They were listening to God's direction. In fact, the hospitality, the greeting that they received, yes, it was provided by Lydia, but I really believe that scriptures are showing us that it is by God's direction. So there they were. They were seeking God in prayer. They sought the Spirit's leadership. They listened to someone they had just met. And just imagine here, the scripture says here, and she prevailed upon us. First of all, interestingly, it was a woman, not a man. It was a merchant, not a synagogue ruler. It was someone from Thyatira, which is, if you remember the map, it's somewhere in Asia Minor, in modern day Turkey now. Not someone from Philippi. So in other words, it was a non-local person, someone not from there. I just find it fascinating that it was a group of women they found. It was one woman whose faith, God had opened up her heart and they shared the message. And then she prevailed upon them to accept her invitation to come to her home. And this is God leading them. The Holy Spirit is at work. And just looking back, and you know, these are just my own thoughts. You may have your own as you consider the scripture and try to figure out the scene for yourself. But to me, it seems like Paul and his companions, they did three things. First of all, they were doing all that they knew was right to do. They were preaching wherever they went. They were trying to encourage people and share about God to everywhere they went, but it seems like doors were being closed. Then when they got to a place where they felt like God was calling them to go, they waited. They remained there for some days. What do we do in this Roman colony? When do we go? But finally, they followed the leadership of God and the hospitality that God was giving them. They listened to Lydia, a woman from Thyatira, and she was a merchant. You know, as I think about this story, it really impresses me. And I'm going to share some things and get to some practical points. And my goal in all this is not to, I don't want to sound like I'm boasting. I pray that I'm not. I pray in the Lord that we can boast about how God is leading us and how we have to be attentive to God and the Holy Spirit leading us. But, you know, when I think about this, I'm reminded of a time, and now it's a little over 2 years ago. Yeah, two years and a few months. The last time when my wife and I were together and we were able to share our faith with someone we had just met, and because of God leading, this person became a disciple. This was in the United States, in California, and it was after a meeting, because sometimes my wife and I would come back to a meeting, and it was actually after a Sunday service, and we had a great Sunday service with our brothers and sisters here in that part of the country. And we had been in America for a while, and we were looking for some Asian food. We love salad, we love pizza, we love burgers, and we'd been in America for a while, but we wanted to find some good Asian food. So we went to the mall, and we saw that some of our group went to have, I think, more of like a salad or something kind of thing. And my wife and I, we decided we wanted to have some Asian food, and so we went for some Korean food. And as we were going, actually, I should preface this a little bit. The night before, we had gone out with another disciple from another part of the world. And we had gone out at dinner time, and this was the night before. And we went to a restaurant. And while we were there, we were catching up because she was a really good friend of my wife's from many years ago. And then she felt really inspired to just afterwards to want to share with the waitress. And we sort of were very friendly with the waitress and talked to her. But to make a long story short, that evening, the sister and myself and Alexa, we didn't actually share the gospel or share with that particular woman. And the next morning, that night and next morning, that sister kind of impressed on us how she felt bad. She felt a little bit guilty for not taking the opportunity. It seemed like a good opportunity. And I felt it too. We felt it a bit. And so when Alexa and I were going for lunch now, the next day, on Sunday after service, we were going to this Korean place. And we sat down. And Alexa went to go look at what to eat or to the restroom, one of those. And I sat there. And this young man was sitting there. And he had just finished eating. And so we just casually struck up a conversation. How was the food? Oh, okay. What did you order? And then where have you been, you know? And then it just turned out that he had gone to a Sunday service himself in the area nearby. I said, really? And I started sharing about what we had done. And then he said, well, you know, and then he kind of talked about how he's actually even church shopping, so to speak, kind of looking for a place where he would enjoy the fellowship. So I said, oh, really? And I started talking about what our fellowship was like, talked with him about what we're learning. And then we even got to a place where we start talking about a scripture in the book of John. And then his mother came by, she was maybe my age, because this was a young man. Make a long story short, we had a great conversation, and I really felt, wow, and Alexa was there too, and we had this conversation, and it was like, how did that happen? Because we had to leave the city, but later on we connected this young man to our church and our ministry there in the city. Make a long story short, a few months later, he studied the Bible and he got baptized. And I'm so excited that he's actually responded so well to the scriptures. And so, but you know, you think about it, what did we do as people? A lot of times we think about what we do. We didn't do anything. I just went there because we were hungry. We just started talking to him because he just finished. I thought he would know something about the food. I really believe that God orchestrated the whole thing. And that, to me, is Holy Spirit leading us. Thank God that we opened our mouths. Thank God that we were listening and paying attention. And, you know, we like to share success stories, right? We like to talk about these things. But even as Mother Teresa said, we are called upon not to be successful, but just to be faithful. And so as I share that story with you, I hope it encourages you. It encourages me when I think about it. But you know what? Right now in my own life, my current challenge or our current challenge or our current struggle is what? Well, sometimes in our lives, we stop. We slow down because we're not sure what to do next. What is the next best step? What is the contribution that I can make in my life to God, to the church, to the community in these days? Where might the Holy Spirit be calling us to go or to share? Where is, quote unquote, our Macedonia I say these things because it really has been on my heart thinking about, okay, I'm a little older than probably many of us listening today. I've been able by the grace of God to see great things, but I've been stopped here in America for months. It seems like the Holy Spirit has stopped us and called us to stop and consider some things. We arrived to the U.S. on December 11th. We planned to stay 1 month to visit family. And then a week before flying back, the Hong Kong government implemented a flight ban because of the Omicron virus that was starting to go around the world and into Asia and in America for sure. And so there were 2 week flight bans happening. So we kept rebooking a flight, rebooking a quarantine hotel. And then 2 weeks later, we thought, okay, it's going to open up. Nope. The flight ban gets extended. It gets extended. It gets extended all the way to late March. Finally, Hong Kong announced that the flight ban would be lifted by April 1. But by then, I had made some other plans. And so for other reasons, we decided we will fly back, Lord willing, to Hong Kong on May 13th and arrive by May 15th. So the good news is that, okay, so far it looks good. And the quarantine hotel time has been reduced from 21 days to only 7. God kept delaying our travel. What did the Holy Spirit allow us to do in this time, though? Because usually, living in Hong Kong, we would come back to visit family for maybe 1 or 2 weeks here, 1 or 2 weeks there. But this time, it's been, wow, 4 months, 5 months with Alexa's mother, with her family nearby, with visiting my family. And I'll just be honest with you. There are too many amazing stories. Too many amazing stories of what has gone on that I praise God for. You know, we were here in the dead of winter, and when you slow down, you have to appreciate the quiet beauty of a tree that is just full of snow, and everything is snow. We hadn't seen snow in years, and now here we are in America in the dead of winter. And then during the dead of winter, or during this quiet time of winter, you know, my mother-in-law, she lives on her own, and she is great. She works really hard to keep herself going. She is in good health for being 93 years old. But there are a lot of things around the house that have kind of, you know, she can't handle it. She can't keep things clean. She can't clean out things like her garage or do her yard work or redecorate, make a long story short. I'm like, okay, I can serve. I can help clean out the garage. I can help clean up the downstairs. I can get rid of things that need to be recycled. I can help figure out, and then with some other people's help, redecorate this family room, which you see here. And by doing these things, you know, it's like therapy for me. I enjoy doing these things that I couldn't do in my small apartment in Hong Kong. It helps my mother-in-law because her home gets set up a little more nicely. It's like therapy. And there's time to think about what God wants us to do in the future. You know, as spring comes around, that same tree that was snow and nothing in the dead of winter, look at it now. It is beautiful. The cherry blossoms are coming out. And you can see, wow, winter turning to spring in this part of America is really beautiful. The cherry trees, the dogwood trees, the green, the birds, the geese. Wow, God's creation really comes back to life. And as I mentioned, it was in April, actually, it was over the Easter weekend that my own family, we were able to gather to honor my father. And it's still a sad thing. You know, so much of my life, I owe my life to my father and my mother. And that we could gather together with my brother, my sister, and a lot of our family and have a meal and share the videos and have the conversations over a 3-day period. It was the right thing to do and it was good for us. And I thank God that we had the time to really gather together like that. And in those family conversations, you know, my sister, who is like almost 5 years younger than me, because I was living overseas for so long, I'd come back and I'd see her for a day or two, or maybe for a week, you know, with our families all together. But then we'd go back and we'd see her next year for about the same amount of time. This time, since I've been here, I've been able to see her for 2 or 3 different occasions, more natural. And, you know, it's like getting reacquainted with someone that I haven't known for 30 plus some odd years because we've been away for so long. And that's such a humbling thing to me because I think God has given that time for us. I think God has given us so much of his hospitality, so much of his provision. I think of the clothes that have been given to me. We didn't come with a lot of winter clothes. The winter boots that someone lent to us so that we could shovel the snow. I think about the fact that one of Alexa's brothers lent a car to us so that we could drive around. We were renting for a while and they realized, oh, you still need to rent. Here, why don't you just use this car? It was so touching that, I mean, it wasn't even their old car, it was their nicest car. So that they provided that to us. And then one really fun thing that my wife, Alex, and I got to do, we got to go see a basketball game. You know, in America, there's something called March Madness, where the colleges have an annual tournament, and they come together. And my favorite team, the team that my brother and I grew up loving in North Carolina, the University of North Carolina Tar Heels, light blue, go Tar Heels. He got tickets for my wife and I to go watch this game. It seems kind of funny, right? But you know, that was the bond that my brother and I have. And he just wanted to treat us, to show us this love. And we were there and it was an incredible game, incredible time. And it was like a bucket list thing for me. And then I think of all the relationships that we've been able to renew, not only just in family, it's already so awesome. My wife's immediate family, my own family, but even this picture here is with myself and Alexa having a dinner at the home of her college roommate and her college roommate's husband, who's also a college friend of Alexa's, and another friend. And these three people, these three college friends of Alexa, prior to this visit here to America, Alexa had not seen for 37 years. So imagine having the conversations about what has been your journey like since college, since going out into the world. And of course, for Alexa, it was becoming a Christian. For myself, it was becoming a Christian. Sharing all that stuff, but sharing about your family, sharing about your kids, sharing about your careers, sharing about your lives. And oh yeah, you know, they got to meet me. That, you know, Alexa, we weren't together back then. I was like, whoa, this is your husband. Wow. 35, 6, 7 years, no contact. And yet God provided this opportunity. True life sharing and faith sharing. And again, I don't want to say this to boast, but I really want to uphold God's timing. The Holy Spirit's leadership. How is it that this could all have been possible if not because of the delay and the timing that God put into our lives? There's a famous Jewish rabbi. His name is Joshua Heschel. He prayed this. He said, I did not ask for success. I asked for wonder. And you gave it to me. You know, God, if we stop and listen and think, God provides so many things for us to be in awe about, in awe of his creation, in awe of his community, in awe of his church. Yes, there are many problems in this world. Yes, the world is full of pain. Yes, we are here. And we have a part to play to show the world the wonder of God. And so in this time of my own struggle and reflection, what does God want me to do? He has bolstered us, supported us. He has empowered us to consider his timing, his leadership, his hospitality. Another thing I want to share about as well is while we've been here, we've been in touch and kept a good connection with our own small group in Hong Kong. And you know, not just myself, not just Alexa, but every one of us, we all want to just contribute to God's life and God's mission. We want to share our lives, share our faith, join in God's mission wherever it is, in whatever way, and make a contribution, especially as you get older. But I know this, for those of us who are younger, setting out, we've like, yes, we know what we need to do, or we want to do this or that. Yes, for the glory of God. As we get older, we still want to do those things. And we believe by the grace of God, we have much to share. This slide here, or this photo here, of this is a Zoom meeting of our small group, and there are altogether of us four couples. Is that right? Yep, four couples. And it's been recently formed. Even while we've been in America, we've been in good touch and added a couple into our group. And in this group now, we're starting to try to do things more and more together. And one way that we're trying to encourage everybody to contribute their own gifts is I'm trying to get everyone to take a turn to share about their gifts and how God motivates them as they give their gifts to others. For example, in this picture, one of the brothers, he's talking about his work. He works as a safety officer in Hong Kong in many different settings. And you know, safety is something that, yes, you get hired to do and it's very important, but it's also something that is very important to God, that we feel safe physically, emotionally, and of course, spiritually, relationally. And so as he talks about safety, as he talks about how he helps a construction site to be safe, we also talk about how, wow, what does that also mean for us as we live in Hong Kong, as we live in the rules that the society has given us, as we think about in our own relationships, how to be safe, or how God wants us to be safe and feel safe. I'm so looking forward to other opportunities for our small group, our Bible talk. Someone may share about, you know, their motivation, their convictions about cooking, about making great meals and what that means. Or we may even just talk simply about the Bible like we always like to do as well. So each of us will get a chance to share our godly convictions, I pray. I pray we'll all take that on. And each one of us will get to share about our work or our passion, all to the glory of God and encouraging others to join in as well. And I'm looking forward to the end of May when we will have our in-person dinner gathering together just with my small group. So as we come to near the end of today's message, I want us to think about John 14. Think about the Holy Spirit and the advocate that Jesus talked about, the one that would come, the one that would remind us of all that he taught us. And then the example in the book of Acts, where Paul and his companions were hurrying up and going and doing all that they knew to do. And then they waited. They waited, and then they looked for a place of prayer, and they found an opportunity to share God's word, and they accepted the kind hospitality of Lydia, as Lydia was actually providing what I believe was God's hospitality to them. And the life of God, the mission of God, the message of God was going forth in an incredible way. So I'm looking forward to the Holy Spirit helping me to keep figuring out how to contribute, how my wife and I to contribute. And I want to leave you with a few questions for you to reflect on in your own lives. You know, the first one is really just about, where is the Holy Spirit leading us, leading you, leading me in my life, in my family relationships, in my community, in my work, in my church? Where is the Holy Spirit leading us? Are you being reminded of any of Jesus' teaching that maybe we've forgotten? You know, for me, I was reminded so strongly, I just need to serve. I just need to serve. I just need to clean things up and redecorate and just keep doing things to serve other people. It's not about me. It's about others. Am I listening? Are we listening to the Holy Spirit? Are we in a place like Philippi where we're not sure what to do? Are we listening to? Are we looking out and seeing the wonder of God? Are we seeing where his hospitality may be leading us? It could be through another person like Lydia. It could be another through the time here where God is saying, stay for a while and share your lives and faith with your family. And finally, what is it that personally I can contribute? What is it personally that I can give to this small group, to this church, to this community, to this family, to this workplace? What is my contribution to God, because he made me and gave me all these things? What can we even as a group do? I pray and hope that today's message is from God, is from the Holy Spirit, and encourages you to keep going, to keep listening to keep watching for and following the Holy Spirit at work. Thank you very much.
The Holy Spirit at work. Daniel, maraming salamat sa iyong napakagandang mensahe. Naniniwala ako na ginabayang ka ng Holy Spirit. In John 14, ipinaliwanag sa atin ni Daniel ng ICOC Hong Kong kung anong ginagawa ng Holy Spirit sa buhay natin bilang disciple. Salitang advocate from the Greek word parakletos, na-encourage ako dahil natutunan ko ang Holy Spirit ay big helper sa buhay natin bilang disciple. Tinutulungan niya tayo magdasal sa ating Amang Diyos. Tinutulungan niya tayo intindiin o unawain ang mga salita ng Diyos tuwing nagbabasa tayo ng Bible. At ang Holy Spirit ang nagbibigay direksyon sa tamang daan na tatahakin natin gaya ng pag-evangelize natin sa mga komunidad. At pinatunayan ito sa mga buhay ng mga disciple noong first century church at ang mga missionaries noon. Gamit ang Acts 16 ni Daniel, nakita ko ang Holy Spirit talaga ang nagbibigay ng direksyon kung paano ang tatahakin din na Paul, Luke at ang mga kasama nilang disciple sa pagpapalaganap ng salita ng Diyos sa kanilang mga missionary journey. At ang Holy Spirit din ang nagbigay ng mga tao kung sino ang marireach out nila kagaya ni Lydia na negosyante at ang kanyang buong sambahayan. Personally, na-experience ko po ito. Nakita ko kung gaano gumalaw ang Holy Spirit sa simbahan po natin dito sa Laguna. Noong 2017, napakalaking tulong ng Holy Spirit para gabayan po kami sa pagpapalaganap ng salita ng Diyos. Mula sa 100 disciple po, mga kapatid natin, pinakalat niya kami sa iba-ibang city, municipalities, sa probinsya po ng Laguna para po magtayo ng mga house churches at mga sector. Dahil sa malaking tulong ng Holy Spirit, ang simbahan po natin sa Laguna ay meron ng apat na sector na merong 234 members. At sa susunod na taon, sa gabay po ng Holy Spirit at sa awa ng ating Diyos, magtatayo po tayo ng dalawang simbahan sa loob mismo ng probinsya ng Laguna. Dahil sa malaking tulong ng Holy Spirit, lahat ng walhati ay para sa Diyos lamang po. Sa ating mga group or small group discussion, binigyan po tayo ni Daniel ng mga katanungan bilang gabay. Una, where is the Holy Spirit leading me or us? Any reminders of Jesus' teaching? Am I listening to the Holy Spirit or are we? Where is God's hospitality leading me or leading us? What can I or we contribute? Bago po tayo magtapos, samahan niyo po ako sa isang panalangin. Ama namin sa langit, maraming pong salamat sa oras na to. Maraming pong salamat sa napakagandang mensahe ng aming kapatid ni Daniel na talagang tinuruan niya kami intindihin paano kami tinutulungan ng Holy Spirit. Ama, sa panahon na hindi namin alam anong direction namin, sa panahon na hindi namin alam anong iisipin pa, sa panahon, ano ang tatahakin namin, hindi namin makita ito. Tulungan nyo kami. Tulungan nyo kami na gabayan kami ng Holy Spirit. Tulungan nyo kami na gabayan kami sa aming pananalita, sa aming puso, sa aming kaisipan. Ama, tunay nga po ang tamang direksyon ay patungo sa inyo. Ang tamang boses po ay galing sa Holy Spirit. At ang tamang direksyon ng buhay namin ay patungo po sa ikarya mo. Ama, maraming pong salamat. Lahat ng ito ay dinadalangin ko sa pangalan ng aming Panginoong Jesucristo. Amen.
Hallelujah, praise Jehovah. From the heavens, praise His name. Praise Jehovah in the highest. All His angels praise proclaim. All His hosts together praise Him. Sun and moon and stars on high. Praise Him, O ye heaven of heavens, and ye floods above the sky. Let the praises give Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is
is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. Let them praises give Jehovah. They were made at His command. Then forever He established. His decree shall ever stand. From the earth, oh, praise Jehovah. All ye floods, ye dragons all. Fire and hail and snow and vapors. Stormy winds that hear Him call. Let them praises give Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. Only fruitful trees and cedars, all ye hills and mountains high, creeping things and beasts and cattle, birds that in the heavens fly. Kings of earth and all ye people, princes, great earth's judges all, praise His name, young men and maidens, aged men and children small. Let them pray and praises give Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky. Let them pray and praises give Jehovah, for His name alone is high. And His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted, and His glory is exalted far above the earth and sky.
We would like to invite everyone to visit and check out our online platforms, ICOC Philippines website, ICOC Philippines Facebook page and YouTube channel, and to know more about our church worldwide, you can visit Disciples Today website and Kidogo YouTube channel. For information on latest updates, lessons, and schedules, please like, subscribe, share, and click the notification bell so we can notify you. Let us do our part in spreading God's word and love by sharing this video.